Hello and welcome to the Fishing Guide Podcast. I tell you what, we have a very special guest today, and that's Chad Hoover. And I tell you what, you have done so much, I don't even know where we need to start. So I'm going to let you tell the people, just in case they've been in a cave, underneath a rock, you know, what you've done, and kind of paraphrase it, because we'll go back and kind of touch base on some of it.
Well, I've been in kayak fishing for a long time. I was a saltwater kayak fisherman and a freshwater kayak fisherman at the same time, but I always hated how every forum, and I'm going to date myself a little bit here, every forum was saltwater heavy, and they would put the freshwater forum at the bottom like the redheaded stepchildren, you know?
Right.
And I was sitting around one day after we'd gone out and we'd caught some fish, and I said, man, somebody should start a kayak bass fishing, you know, group only. And right. Three people in the room all just turned their heads and looked at me and said, why don't you do it? And I'm like, I don't want to start a group, you know? And they're like, dude, just get the website. I'm like, I don't know how to build a website. They're like, you don't even have to build it. Just buy it. I'm like, I don't know how to buy a website.
Right.
So a guy that was in the room, there was a buddy of mine. He's like, I'll buy the website and give it to you, but I'll at least lock it down. So he bought the website and he transferred it to me like a month later. And that's how I got the website, kayakbassfishing.com.
Right.
And then everybody wanted to create a forum, so I created a forum. And then once we created a forum, then everybody wanted to do tournaments, but I didn't want to travel and do tournaments yet, so we started online catch photo release, or CPR as we call it,
right?
Challenges. And the main reason that I called them challenges is the beginning is, you know, there's a lot of northern states and, you know, some in the South and the Midwest that have these restrictions on tournaments. And so if I called it a challenge, we didn't have to worry about any of the permits or the crazy stuff, because you can't have a tournament on this lake. We're having a challenge. You can't have a challenge on this lake. Where does it say that? Well, it says in our rules you can't have a tournament. Yeah, we're not having a tournament. We're having a challenge. So we lived in that gray area for a long time. And now as kayak fishing has gotten more and more popular and, you know, people have gotten wise to it, we started doing more live events. And once we did a couple of live events, everybody's like, we need a championship. So we started the Kayak Bass Fishing National Championship. And then people were like, well, if you do a championship but you don't have a way to build your way up to it, it's kind of a lottery fishing tournament, and it's a crapshoot. So then we built the Kayak Bass Fishing Trail, and then once we built the Kayak Bass Fishing Trail, everybody said, if we're going to have a trail, we have to have an Angler of the Year. So it's kind of been really one of these, like, just, you know, reluctantly in the beginning drug into. Then kind of I got fired up about it, and I got excited about it, and I really love giving anglers opportunity. I've been very blessed in this sport. You know, a lot of it had to do with timing. You know, I got out there early. I got out there in the beginning and kind of got to be at the forefront of it. I was also blessed with the fact that I was I went through college in Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University, so I had an aeronautical engineering and professional aeronautics background, and I was flying in the Navy at the time. So a lot of my early, you know, quote-unquote contributions to kayak design was I was taking stuff from aviation and saying, let's move this into kayak fishing. Like, my first ever ram mount that I put on a kayak was a ram mount that I took off of a helicopter and said, this would be great for a depth finder. Then I contacted the company Ram.
Right.
And then I started really beseeching a company that I was affiliated with, then a company called Wilderness Systems. We got to put tracks on kayaks. And they're like, for what? I'm like, for track-mounted accessories. They're like, what track-mounted accessories? I was like, well, there'll be track-mounted accessories, but we got to make the tracks first. And they're like, what are you talking about? You want us to build a kayak to work with a product that doesn't exist yet? I'm like, yes, because as soon as the kayak companies make the tracks, the companies will have to make the product. And they literally looked at me like I had a unicorn horn growing out of my head.
Right.
But I finally convinced them to do it. And then a number of companies came along trying to do it, you know, to satisfy it, but they just weren't visionary enough. Those companies have kind of fallen by the wayside. But I was able to convince a good buddy of mine, Luther from Yak Attack, like, dude, you don't need to just build a Visicarbon light.
Right.
Because originally Yak Attack was be safe, be seen, be visible. And it was a safety company. Uh-huh. And I said, dude, there's way more to rigging than there is to safety. So here's the thing. Make something that works with the tracks. Everybody is wanting to put the screws through the product and into the track, but then you have to have the exact correct length through bolt to go into a fitting. The bolt needs to come from the bottom. So he went out and developed a T-bolt system to where then you could tighten it up and you could move it around. And I firmly believe that the T-bolt or the introduction of the track-mounted accessories was kind of the dawn of the innovation game in kayak fishing. I also feel like it was the dawn of the monkey see, monkey do game in kayak fishing. If this kayak company makes an innovation, every kayak company then copies it.
Right.
And so we don't get these sweeping innovations. We get these incremental innovations, and then everybody copies it. Once everybody's got that, then one person steps forward and gets another little small group. And so there hasn't been any real dynamic swings, you know, to a certain extent in kayak fishing. But what's crazy about it is once an idea is validated with the audience,
mm-hmm.
and as long as it's not patented or as long as the companies can get around it, they, everybody adopts it. Jackson was the first high-low seat. What's crazy right. about it is I tried to get Wilderness Systems to do a high-low seat 3 years before that, and they just wouldn't do it. They're like, no, nobody wants to be that high. The kayaks will have to – the kayaks will flip over. And I'm like,
right.
then make the kayak to where it works with the seat. You know, and to give credit where credit is due, Drew Gregory was able to convince Eric Jackson
right.
and the Jackson Kayak team to make kayaks specifically designed for fishing.
Yep.
Whereas every other company in the beginning was, let's make a kayak that has a wreck appeal, but it's also good for fishing, and then let's try to split the difference. And I think that the kind of the powder keg moment in this industry is when companies started to realize that by making a wreck kayak that they treated as a fishing kayak and doing the wreck thing first, they were leaving way too much, you know, off the table. And they realized, we'll make a great fishing kayak, and if people want to paddle it wreck, they can,
right.
but we're going to focus on fishing first. And every major manufacturer now's flagship brand of every major manufacturer is a fishing kayak. Their number one selling brand is a fishing kayak. And so if there's something I'm proud of, it's being the Pied Piper, because I'll be honest with you, I was at ICAST and the Bassmaster Classic. I was the first person at either one of those shows in a trade show, in a booth with a kayak at either of those shows. And literally people called me, a guy called me a moron to my face at ICAST the first year. He said, you're crazy. An idiot and a friggin' moron if you think people are going to fish out of that for bass. I said, okay.
Yeah.
And then what's crazy about it is I think we're 6 out of the last 8 years best of show. So right. we didn't just come into ICAST and now we're relevant. Like, we own it.
Right.
Like, come on. There's no other product category that's gotten 6 out of 8 years ever. And we just got 6 out of the last 8 years. And so the most recent thing that's happened in the world has recency bias. But I didn't make any, oh, my God, you know, philosophical debates come to fruition. I wasn't prophetic. It's common sense in my world. It's the best way to fish.
Right.
It's the easiest way to fish. It's the most effective way to fish. And I'll tell you where the pendulum swing okay. happened for me. When I used to catch a 10-pound bass out of a kayak when I started, people were like, oh, my God, I can't believe you caught that from a kayak. Now when you catch a 10-pound bass out of a kayak, the rest of the world goes, oh, well, you caught it out of a kayak, like you're cheating. You know what I'm saying? So it went from, like, a special right. thing because you caught it out of a kayak to now, like, oh, well, you caught that out of a kayak. You didn't catch that out of a real boat. Okay, cool. I'm good with that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And so to me, that's what's been exciting. That's what's been amazing. I think the people in the sport of kayak fishing are like a big family.
Uh-huh.
Granted, there's some dysfunction here and there, just like any family.
Right.
But I think that it's the most cohesive group of outdoors people in the world. It doesn't happen in hiking. It doesn't happen in motorcycle world. It doesn't happen in archery. It doesn't happen in other facets of fishing. But the world of kayak fishing is literally, you can post up on Facebook, you're going somewhere, and somebody will invite you to stay at their house. Like right. in the world of Facebook and Craigslist murderers and stalkers and all that right. crazy stuff, kayak fishing is just this weird, crazy, you know, borderline cult of people that are like a family. And you know the thing, and the folks that are just listening to this right. aren't going to be able to see what I'm doing. But dudes out there and people that are in the outdoor industry will know what I'm talking about, even if they're not a dude. But when you walk past somebody and you do the head nod, you're like, what's up, man? You know, that head nod thing?
Yep, that's
everybody
right.
with a kayak, if you pull up to a boat ramp, it's like the what's up. It's like the Jeep wave, you right. know, or the motorcycle point at the ground thing
that's
that
right.
motorcycle riders do. Kayak fishermen have that same thing, and it's like a weird deal. Hey, you want me to help you load your kayak? Hey, man, you need help with that? hey, dude, you got, and you would never motor up to another boat. Well, maybe if you're like up north, maybe you'd never motor up to another boat, grab onto their rub rail and like ask them if they've got a whatever. Right. I have people constantly come up to my kayak, paddle right up, hook their heel on my kayak and be like, hey man, you got another swim bait? I'll get you back. And I'm like, yeah, man, here's a pack. And you don't even think anything about it. That just doesn't exist, in my opinion, in any other genre of any sport, you know? To the extent that kayak fishermen are almost a little bit too generous. You tell the wrong person about your fishing spot, and the whole damn world will know about it in about 3 weeks. But I love it. I think it's the greatest family, the greatest community on earth. And, you know, I'm blessed to be in a position where we started a group early on, and that group has evolved and become one of the largest groups of fishermen in the world. It's the largest kayak fishing group in the world, but it's definitely one of the largest fishing groups in the world, and we're like a big family, and I love it.
Yeah, so in case people don't know about it, tell them about how you, you know, I guess I'm going to say measure, because now everyone knows, but how you, instead of weighing the fish, you use a measuring system, because some people haven't competed in it.
Right,
and
right.
They want to know, because that's big. You were talking about catch and release.
So what we do is we do catch, photo, release.
Uh-huh.
And that's a standard that we use because we don't have live whales.
Right.
If you tried to put a live whale on a kayak, which I've done to use for holding a fish for video, or I've done redfish tournaments where they wanted a live weigh in and I built a live whale into one of my kayaks. Uh-huh. The problem is weight. And water weighs a lot. So when you build a live well in a boat, you know, just 8 gallons is 64 pounds. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
And then the space that you need to put that weight in there, and then the effect on center of gravity on the boat is a problem. And so catch, photo, release was just the way we started doing it, you know, back in 95, 96, 97. And originally catch, photo, release was no joke. It was disposable cameras.
Yeah.
And you would get a number on them. We would issue the cameras at the captain's meeting.
Uh-huh.
And we'd write your number down.
Wow.
The next day, you would bring that camera back. We would give you a claim ticket.
Uh-huh.
We would put the camera in a Ziploc bag. We'd put them in a box. We would take them to a one-hour photo.
Wow.
Everybody would hang out at the bonfire or captain's meeting or shrimp boil or whatever. You would get the one-hour photo developed. By the way, one-hour photo is not an hour. That's like an approximation. That would be 2-3 hours sometimes. Right. We had events early days where by the time we got ready to do the tournament, some of the people that were in the top five couldn't even stand up to get their check. And I'm not advocating that. I'm just saying in history we had crawfish bowls where dudes couldn't even stand up to get their trophy or their check. So we've kind of started to – the age of digital cameras sped that up quite a bit. But even when digital cameras came out, you would have to check in. We would take your memory card.
Okay.
We'd give you a claim check. And then the judges or the administrators would have to go in the back and download those photos, sort through them, score them, and then move into allocating those and then putting them onto a leaderboard. There was a lot more mystery back then because nobody knew what anybody had until the very end. And there is a certain nostalgia about that. I plan on having some no-look tournaments in the future where nobody knows who won, who caught anything until the end. And I think that's going to be the throwback and to give it that mystery and that feel.
Right. Anticipation. Who really, you know you got good fish, but do you have good enough fish?
Did somebody catch fish better than you?
Uh-huh.
And things like that. But, you know, then we moved into the era of Tourney X came along as a tournament management system. iAngler came along as a tournament management system. Tourney X was the clear, you know, better choice at that time. There was a number of other apps that tried to play in that space. A number of companies, you know, bigger companies have tried to develop their own apps.
Uh-huh.
You know, and then recently, I say recently they came into the kayak space, but a company called Fishing Chaos has been around for 6 years, and they've been working in the big boat market and saltwater catch weigh release tournaments and developed a really good protocol. And so, you know, Tourney X is still a fantastic format. It just didn't seem to work for some of our really big tournaments. And so we moved over to Fishing Chaos this year. And, but the great thing about it is there's somewhat of a riff in some communities about it, but here's how I look at it. There's great opportunities on Tourney X. Uh-huh. There's great opportunities on Fishing Chaos. There's great opportunities if somebody else builds another app, because I'm a fan of this sport first.
Right.
And I'm a person who does it. I'm a kayak angler first. And so to me, opportunity, competition, and innovation all go hand in hand. They're kind of like the three legs of a fire triangle. Mm-hmm. You know, oxygen, the catalyst, and the fuel. Yep. And so to me, when you, if I'm able to introduce one more source, or if I'm able to be the catalyst, or if I'm able to add fuel, I plan on always doing that. And, you know, some people call that being disruptive. I call it thinking of the community first, because you have to be willing to break eggs to make omelets. You've got to be willing to go through a little bit of a transition period if you ever want to get better. And I'm a fan of Tourney X competing with Fishing Chaos, and Fishing Chaos competing with Half a Spot and Tourney X, and they all compete against each other.
Right.
Because if they're all forced to get better, again, going back to what I said, I'm a kayak angler first. So as a kayak angler, I win when we win, and we win when companies compete to try to be better than each other. And that's true with Ford, Chevy, Dodge. That's true with Pepsi, Coke, Dr. Pepper. You know, it's true in any world where there's innovation and there's competition, the consumer wins. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. And so for me, you know, I take some arrows in the back by being the pioneer, and it's part of it. And I wear that, you know, cloak. I have no problem with it. It's part of it. I've got thick skin. I think it's funny sometimes in social media where people throw things out there and they expect it to register with me. And I'm like, I spent 20 years in the military, 20 years in the Navy, half of that in combat search and rescue, and the other half of it in some of the craziest stuff that people do. You're going to have to get up way early in the morning to ruffle my feathers with a Facebook post. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I think it takes a certain type of personality to do what I do and a certain type of resolve.
Right.
And I'm very fortunate that God blessed me with that personality and that resolve and that, you know, mental block or fortitude, or I don't know, whatever you want to call it, to just push through all that stuff. Because I do feel like it benefits the community. And if I didn't, I wouldn't do it, because my number one goal is to not just be disruptive, but to be disruptive for a reason. And that reason is for progress, you know?
Yep.
And so, but I think catch, photo, release, and more importantly, and I've said this a couple of other places, but this is probably the biggest platform that I've ever said this on. Uh-huh. I ultimately think catch, video, release is the future.
Yep.
Catch, photo, release is good, but catch, because things can be manipulated in photos, but the ability to take a fish out of the water, show it live, show your measuring board unaltered, lay the fish on it. You know what I'm saying? Take the fish off, show it swim off live. And then know that you got an accurate measurement, and know that at any time you could scan through that video and find the exact perfect measurement, and you could look for, you know, subtle clues and things like that, and then back it up with a video or photo.
Yep.
I think the photo, catch, photo, release with video verification is the future. And then I think very shortly after that, we transition into catch, video, release with photo verification. And then we've got the best of both worlds. There's already tours that require these guys to run, you know, cameras, GoPros or Tacticams or action cams or whatever. And honestly, man, with the way 5G is going with phones, I've already had one company contact me, and this kind of gives me goosebumps when I even talk about it. They said, we have an IMD that we could give you to issue to your anglers that would be able to stream live video from the kayak real time. And I said, what's an IMD? They said, oh, I'm sorry, that's an internet mobile device. It's basically a cell phone that doesn't call.
Right.
But it just connects to the internet.
Wow.
And I said, what internet? They're like, oh, the World Wide Web on 5G. And just so you know, if your phone doesn't have 150 apps on it and 45 things running in the background, and it has to be searching for a cellular signal, it actually needs way less signal to have to provide latent video. So we are very close to turning the corner on doing live tournaments where you take an internet mobile device.
Right.
You put it on a mount, you put it on the front and the back of a kayak, and at any time I can peek in as the tournament organizer, the tournament director, on an angler. We could create a button, or actually I talked to them the other day about it, and they said they could do voice control. You set the hook. You could say fish on. And when you say fish on, it goes to a headquarters. Yep. And we're able to click a button and show you fighting the fish live. Now, Bass does that. Major League Fishing does that. But they also do that with almost $1 million worth of cameras and equipment and live streaming technology and a staff of about 12 people to pull that off. How crazy is it going to be that one day we're going to be able to do this very soon with a box similar to your Rode podcasting box as a or a laptop and run a tournament with hundreds of people, and anytime somebody hooks a fish, you can – and then they also said, well, we could build software for the back end where when somebody catches a fish, if you happen to have multiple, you just tap the screen and hit record, and it'll record the one that's catching the fish that you can't go to, and you can say, all right, guys, well, while we were checking out Bill's fish – Timmy hooked up with a nice, you know, 23-incher. Let's take a look. And you could go back and take a look at that. And to me, that's the future.
Yeah, like a loop. And
it's
you a, just
such
go
a cool,
back.
Yeah, exactly.
Awesome.
It's the same.
Yeah.
And what they're doing is they're taking off-the-shelf technology that already exists for other brands, and they're moving that in. You know, augmented measurements are coming. AI that measures your fish for you is already done by a company that I work with. And it's just a matter of transitioning the community to understand it. But just like on your iPhone, when you press a button and you can move it and it measures, that's basically pixel shift measurement. So you can literally take that same technology and it'll automatically recognize the measuring board, recognize the fish, and say, is this fish 23 inches? And you click OK. You can turn the phone on with a technology in the app that just you touch a board and it opens the phone. You hold it up, it automatically takes a photo and it measures the fish for you and it submits it to the leaderboard. That's
Be
the
awesome.
Stuff. That's the stuff I'm excited about. And that's not 10 years from now kind of stuff. That's a year from now, 2 years from now kind of stuff.
Kayak anglers are going to embrace that.
Oh, my God.
Like,
and
they'll be awesome.
And wait till that happens on the world of bass boat market. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, I'm a big fan of everything that's all about conservation.
Right.
Is hanging a fish on a scale better than putting it in a live well and running around for 4 hours or 6 hours or 8 hours and then trailering it? Absolutely.
Yep. Yep.
But is laying a fish on a board where it's supported better than hanging it on a scale? It is if that fish is over 6 pounds.
Right.
It is if that fish is over 23 inches because, you know, all the data tells us if you've got that big fish and you're hanging it on a scale and it shakes its head, you're doing damage. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. So the more we could do for conservation – you know, the better off we are. I hope there's a day when I can help design a kayak where the measuring board fits in a groove in the center of the board, and when you catch the fish, you can lay it on the board, but the fish is laying in water.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
And then you keep the fish wet.
Right.
You keep the board wet. You get your measurement. You do it, catch, video, release with the photo verification, and we treat these fish with the respect they deserve.
Yep.
We're able to pioneer conservation at a whole new level, you know?
And that takes us to the reason why we're here.
All right.
Is because we're at the Fat Tire Fishing Throwdown and River Cleanup.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Which, someone got thrown in as tournament director, and I don't want to mention any names.
Yeah, yeah. But, I think I got voluntold I was the tournament director because I've run tournaments.
Because
so, yeah, you know.
You run tournaments and all of a sudden.
That's what I do.
Oh, yeah, wait, you're a mechanic? You get to fix the cars.
Exactly.
Now, in this case,
exactly.
You get to do that. So that's
well, I mean, this
awesome.
Is an easy one. This is five people, so it's going to be pretty straightforward. We're running it on the app we talked about. We're running it on Fishing Chaos. And it's going to be fun.
Yep.
I'm more excited about the river cleanup part.
And that part's going to have some influence on the results of the tournament.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
We're pretty excited that Fat Tire was able to jump on board here and help out and make
I
sure
was
you
excited
guys
about
didn't
the
go.
Fact, I was excited about the fact that they offered an 8-inch contribution to the total based on your trash bag.
That's right.
And I know it. AJ's going to catch at least, or EJ's going to catch at least 8 inches. You see what I'm saying?
And we're at EJ's house.
Yeah.
So
amen.
We're not afraid to throw him under the bus.
No. And he's not,
absolutely.
He's not so tall that it's a big stretch to get him under the bus anyway. And he pretty much lives on a bus, you know, so, you know.
Exactly.
It's perfect.
So that takes us to Tackle Time. And of course, Tackle Time sponsored by PICO Lures. They make lures for all game fish, any kind you're trying to catch, from walleye, crappie, bass, white bass, stripers, probably everything you've caught in your life.
Yes, sir.
And of course, they catch saltwater fish too.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
So we're real happy that they're our sponsors and they have something for you. Make sure you check them out at picolures.com. And also, Smith Products is our other sponsor, and they make all kinds of tools. knife sharpeners, hook sharpeners, anything that you want, a kind of a tool, they have it. And so you can check them out at smithproducts.com. This was the Regal River. This was their clippers, which is really nice. So when you clip your line, make sure you put it in the trash. Don't throw it in the water. So make sure you check them out at smith.com. And that takes us to, if they want to check out more about you, company, where would they go? What website?
They go to kayakbassfishing.com. Okay. I strongly encourage them to check out kayakbassfishing.com/join. Okay. Which is where you can join Kayak Bass Fishing.
All right.
We're really excited about the fact that if you join at the ambassador level, which is where we look for support to keep doing what we're doing.
Right.
For $25, you get $65 in gift certificates from top manufacturers. It's nothing like one of those gift bags you get that you're like, what am I going to do with all this? It's stuff you get to pick out what you want from the top manufacturers out there. I've pledged to try to make that $100 by the end of the year, so you get $4 back for every dollar you spend. We're doing some cool things for conservation, for youth advocacy, for safety, and your support by joining KBF helps us do that.
There you go. And there's EJ himself. He's just sneaking in. Like, he can't stop sneaking in on your day, your podcast.
You should almost get one of those little parrot stands, little perches, and just let him sit right there for the whole podcast. You know what I'm saying?
I'll just put the mic
that
right
way
there.
He feels part of it. You know what I'm saying?
You got
that little elf stool over there. You should just bring that thing over here and just sit AG in the middle.
Have you told them about us yet?
No.
All right.
Everybody already knows. It's not like it's news. You know what I'm saying?
There you go.
So, yeah, EJ and I are going to start a show kind of like Jeff Dunham.
Right.
And EJ's going to be my dummy. He's just going to sit on my lap, and we're going to do a full comedy show.
Oh, my God. There you have it. Well, I guess we'll just wrap it up on that.
All right.
Hopefully we didn't run it too long.
No,
I know,
man,
we're
good.
I know we're not
it.
Too short.
No, no.
Because he left. But anyway, we appreciate you being here.
All right, man. Thanks for having me.
Like I always say, make sure you keep your hook sharp and your lures in the water.
All right. Thank you, man.